Well, it's good to see all of you again today. In this session, I'm going to give you a little test, and it's not difficult. So I don't worry about it, but I want you to fill out the answers to this test. It's called the story. And first of all, we're going to read it, and then I'll give you a little time to answer the questions. Okay, the story. A businessman had just turned off the lights in a store when a man appeared and demanded money. The owner opened a cash register. The contents of the cash register were scooped up and a man sped away. A member of the police force was notified promptly. Now, basing your answers on the above story, are the following statements true, false, or questionable? Okay? True, false, or questionable. And I'm just going to give you a few minutes to go through and answer these questions, and then we'll go over them and compare our answers at the end, okay? This is to illustrate one of the concepts that we were talking about yesterday. Okay, let's look at the answers to this. Number one, a man appeared after the owner had turned off his store lights. What answer did you get to that? True, false, or question mark? Anybody?
True.
True? Okay. Anybody else get anything different?
Question mark.
Okay, question mark. Why did you have a question mark?
The story says a businessman had just turned off the lights, and that could be a different person from the owner.
Exactly. So that's a question mark. Okay, let's move on. The robber was a man. True or false or question?
True.
True?
Question.
Question? Why did you get a question mark? It's question mark. Why question, Igor?
Well, it could be man or woman.
Okay. And wasn't necessarily a robbery either, was it?
Yes,
so
that's right.
It has to be a question mark. Okay, number three. The man did not demand money. Is that true or false or question mark?
It's true.
Question mark.
Okay, who else got anything else? Larissa, number three.
Yeah. Number three is false because the man is the man who is referred to as the man in the story.
Okay, the man
so
did not
false.
Demand money.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Number four, the man who opened the cash register was the owner.
True.
False. It's question.
Question. Why is it a question mark?
I think it's true. Mm-hmm. Because we have the owner opened a cash register.
Mm-hmm.
So it's can be only true.
But the answer is question, because was the owner a man? We know the owner opened the cash register, but we don't know that it was a man. So there we have a problem again. Yeah, Olga.
It is said that a businessman opened the owner.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's question mark.
It's a question.
Yes.
Yes, questionable.
Good. Okay, number six. Someone opened a cash register.
It's true.
True.
You're all asking, questioning whether it's true. See, it's true. It's true. This is an easy one for us here. Okay. Number seven. After the man who demanded the money scooped up the contents of the cash register, he ran away. True, false, or question mark?
Question.
Question mark. You got it. It's a question mark. Of course, we don't know who scooped up the contents of the cash register or that the man necessarily ran away. He sped away. Maybe he was on a motorbike.
Yeah.
You never know. Okay, number eight. While a cash register contained money, the story does not state how much. True, false, or question?
Question mark.
Question why, Sasha?
Because it may not have had the money. So it may have something, but it doesn't exactly say that there is money in the cash.
Exactly. That's a question mark. Cashes. Yes, it could have been peanuts in the cash register. Or checks. Exactly. All right, number 9. The robber demanded money of the owner. Question mark? True? False?
It's false.
Question.
Why question? Why is it a question?
It is a question mark because he may have demanded money from the businessman and not the owner, mm-hmm. right?
Or it is a question mark also because it might not have been a robber. It mm-hmm. might have been the owner's
yeah.
son, or you don't know. He demands money. Sons can demand money sometimes. Okay, good. We're almost done. Number 10. The story contains a series of events in which only the following persons are referred to: the owner of the store, a man who demanded money, and a member of the police force. True, false, or question mark? Okay, why do you say question, Nina?
I say question because we don't know whether a businessman was the owner of the shop or not.
That's exactly right. This is a question mark. And finally, the number 11. The following events were included in the story. Someone demanded money, a cash register was opened, its contents were scooped up, and a man dashed out of the store. True, false, or question mark?
True.
Sounds like true.
The answer is question mark.
Dashed?
That's right. He may not have dashed away. He could have sped away on roller skates or something else. We really, do we know how he actually left the store? Oh, you've done very well. I actually did this test with a group of PhD students, and they didn't do very well on it at all either, because what's happening here? What has caused us to have so many differences in our answers? Why did we get some wrong answers, so many wrong answers to this? What were we doing?
Well, we all made assumptions about who the man was, who the businessman was, and who the robber was,
right.
and proceeding from that, we gave our answers.
Okay, so exactly. We jumped to conclusions. We made assumptions based on what we read, and we do that all the time. We jump to conclusions. This can get us into a lot of trouble. In another culture, because the rules are all different, everything has changed, and suddenly we start making assumptions about what we understand, and it doesn't always come out right. We're not always correct in what we assume. How can we avoid doing this in another culture if it's such an important thing? How can we avoid suddenly jumping to the conclusions or making such hasty judgments in other places and cultures that are new to us? What are some things we can do?
Probably, as we said before, it's just try to withhold the judgment and try to investigate as much as possible details.
Mm-hmm.
And if we understood the terms right, and mm-hmm. So just ask more questions. Mm-hmm. That's what mm-hmm. people say when you come to a new culture. It takes you longer time just to understand the things and to understand properly the terms or names. Mm-hmm. Or mm-hmm. then otherwise you just talk in another language and nobody understands you.
So you said two really important things there. You said, first of all, suspend judgment. And this is something we talked about yesterday, and that means within yourself you have to wait and sort of say, now really am I understanding what is going on here? And then the second thing that you said is you need to inquire. You need to ask about the terms, about the situation, find out from someone else. Is there anything else we can do to avoid making these kinds of snap judgments when we're in a new situation?
I guess there are Bible verse that we need to be quick to listen and too slow to speak. And I think it can be applied anywhere and for sure here when we in different culture.
So it's important to listen very carefully, be quick to listen and slow to speak. That's wonderful that you brought that out from the scripture. That's that is something all of us need to remember. And I think sometimes when we're in other cultures, we're a little anxious, and we tend to speak quickly, you know, because of that. And we need to hold back and suspend judgment and then listen carefully to what people are saying. Is there anything else that we can do to keep from falling into this trap?
Well, I guess we could always do some homework before we go to a different country and somehow broaden our frame of reference before we even jump into that. In other words, do some theory and see how different that culture might be from ours, and that makes us be a little slow to respond.
So in being prepared before we ever get into the other culture.
Frame of reference ahead of time, just a little bit, even in theory, because that helps to gear out some important tests in practice.
And there are always exceptions to those rules, but at the same time, generally they often are what you will see and you will encounter. And so it's important. And you do your homework by reading, looking at the theory, as you said, and also you talk to people that have been there and experienced it. And you know, one of the things that I found is that people who have adjusted to another culture are often much better at explaining that culture than the people who come from the culture themselves. If you think about it, if somebody said to you, what are the rules of your culture? You would say, well, I don't know, because you're so embedded in your own culture and it's all so unconscious. But somebody that's been there and they come back, they can say, this is how it's different, because they have had to go through that comparison and that adjustment. And that's a great way to do your homework as well, is to talk to people that have been there and can help you. Now, sometimes they're people who have never really thought very much, and those are the kind of people you want to avoid because they, you know, they just see the surface. But people who have thought deeply about their adjustment process can be very helpful to you before you go. That's true. So, any other thoughts on this little story that we did? You did very well. You did as well as anybody ever does on this. It always is quite amazing to me how difficult it is, because so much of our life is spent making these kinds of judgments. We have to make inferences wherever we are. And so it's part of who we are. It's part of being a human being. But it's something we need to be much more careful about when we get into another situation that's very different from ours. Thoughts or comments that you want to make on this concept of hasty judgments?
While we continue being a benevolent project, your kind donations will continue to be vital in fulfilling the calling of TVS Ministry. We do count on your gracious support and cooperation. For detailed information, visit www.tvseminary.com.
Well, then let me just summarize a little bit. We talked about some of the ways that we can avoid making these hasty judgments or these conclusions and getting into trouble. We can suspend judgment within ourselves by saying, okay, I'm going to wait and see. We can listen very carefully to what people are saying. We can do our homework, and we can prepare ahead of time and read and study and talk to people. We can observe better when we're in the culture. We can look more carefully and watch how people respond first before we respond to a given situation. And that will help us to be better cultural learners. I just want to finish with a newspaper story that I read several years ago that sort of, it's kind of a funny story that gives you the idea of what happens when you jump to conclusions. This man was saying, while teaching in Malaysia in the Peace Corps, I was invited to spend a week with a student and his family. We bathed each morning in the river, and one time I displayed my athletic ability by swimming across the river and back. The village youngsters gave me an ovation, as an older native commented, "It must be wonderful to have magic skin." I assured him that my white skin was no different from his darker olive-colored skin. "You're wrong," the man replied. "White skin must be magic. If one of us swam across the river, the crocodiles would eat him." So there was a very dangerous assumption and hasty conclusion that this poor Peace Corps student made. So hopefully we'll never get into that situation where we make assumptions that way. Thank you very much for your attention here in this session. Thank you.
Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 verses 10-11. How to give to TVS Ministry. You may give online at efta.org/givenow. In the description place, write Russia Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Or make checks out to EFCA. Write on the check memo line, Russian Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Mail to EFCA Donor Services, 901 East 78th Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55420-1300. Or send your gift through PayPal for tvs.gift@gmail.com.